The hearing will come to order. The subcommittee meets today to receive testimony on the military services fifth generation tactical aircraft challenges and to receive an update on the F-35 Joint Strike Fighter program. I want to welcome our distinguished witness panel for today, Lieutenant General Chris Bogdan, United States Air Force F-35 Program Executive Officer, Lieutenant General John M. Davis, United States Marine Corps Deputy Commandant for Aviation, Rear Admiral DeWolf Chip Miller, United States Navy, Navy Director of Air and Warfare, and Lieutenant General Select Jerry D. Harris, United States Air Force Deputy Chief of Staff for Plans, Programs, and Requirements. Gentlemen, we thank you for your service and we look forward to your important testimony today. Before we begin, we'd like to take care of some administrative details. I'm pleased to announce that Paul Cook will again be serving as the Vice Chairman of this subcommittee. Paul, thank you for agreeing to be Vice Chairman.
Thank you.
I now will turn to introducing the new members who are on the subcommittee. Our new members include Don Bacon, who represents Nebraska's 2nd Congressional District, a retired Air Force Brigadier General. Don has commanded twice at the wing level at Offutt Air Force Base and Ramstein, Germany. Matt Gates represents Florida's 1st District, home of one of the largest military districts in the country, including Naval Air Station Pensacola and Eglin Air Force Base. Trent Kelly represents Mississippi's 1st District. A colonel in the Mississippi Army National Guard, he has served for 30 years as an engineer, including multiple tours in Iraq. We also have Jim Banks, who represents Indiana's 3rd District, home of 122nd Fighter Wing of Indiana National Guard. A Navy supply officer, he has recently completed a tour in Afghanistan. We're glad to have our new members of the subcommittee, and I'll now turn to our ranking member, Ms. Tsongas, who will also introduce the new members who are our Democrats.
Thank you, Mr. Turner, and look forward to working with you and welcome all those who are here today to testify. I'd like to recognize our new members to the subcommittee. First, I'd like to welcome my colleagues, Jim Langevin of Rhode Island and Jim Cooper of Tennessee, who are by no means new to HASC. Both Mr. Langevin and Mr. Cooper are ranking members, Mr. Langevin on emerging threats and capabilities, Mr. Cooper on strategic forces subcommittees. Mr. Cooper actually also served on this subcommittee as recently as the 113th Congress, and we are lucky to have him back. I'd also like to recognize additional new members of the subcommittee who are also new to Congress. Congresswoman Jackie Rosen of Nevada's 3rd Congressional District most recently served as a president of the largest Reform synagogue in southern Nevada. Her district is just a short drive from Nellis Air Force Base and home to the U.S. Air Force Warfare Center. Congressman Salud Carbajal represents the 24th Congressional District of California, which is home to a number of military facilities, including Vandenberg Air Force Base. Congressman Carbajal served 8 years in the United States Marine Corps Reserve, including active duty service during the 1991 Gulf War. Congressman Anthony Brown represents Maryland's 4th Congressional District and previously served as Maryland's Lieutenant Governor and Majority Whip in the House of Delegates. Congressman Brown was awarded the Legion of Merit for his 30 years of distinguished military service and the Bronze Star for his service in Iraq. Congressman Tom O'Halloran served for 8 years in the Arizona State Legislature before coming to Congress. Prior to his time as an elected official, Tom served on the Chicago Board of Trade and was a small business owner. And Congressman Tom Suozzi represents the North Shore of Long Island as well as Northwestern Queens. Previously, he served as mayor of his hometown, Glen Cove, New York, and was a county executive of Nassau County. Again, thank you and welcome. We welcome them all, not all here today, but I'm sure we'll be participating on a regular basis.
Thank you, Ms. Tsongas. I want to thank you again for your commitment to the bipartisan spirit of this subcommittee, which I know we'll see in our new members also as a result of your leadership and our relationship. This is a timely hearing and is complementary to our Chairman McThorne-Mary's full committee hearing on the state of the military. Last week, the committee heard testimony from each of the military services vice chiefs of staff that the force is strained and that the services have to do more with less. These challenges, combined with years of budget-driven national security strategies and cuts rather than threat-based strategies, have led to a military readiness crisis. With a new administration indicating its intent to rebuild the U.S. Armed Forces, I look forward to working with them to reverse this harmful trend in military readiness. Modernization and building capacity are critical components of restoring readiness. This brings us to today's focus, fifth-generation tactical fighter requirements and the F-35 strike fighter program. This is the third oversight hearing the committee has held over the past year on the requirements and the importance of the fifth-generation fighters given current and emerging threats. And this is a critical time for the F-35. One of these hearings was at the National Museum of the United States Air Force at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base on June 18, 2016, and the witness then, Major General Jerry Harris, here with us today, and then Vice Commander of Air Combat Command, showed us a striking picture of one half of an F-35 strike fighter and one half of a Chinese J-31 fighter joined together. It looked like one aircraft, and it left no one to doubt that our adversaries are extremely close to fielding fifth-generation fighter programs of their own. With only 187 F-22s and 219 F-35s being produced, we will have very limited fifth-generation capacity. The F-35 strike fighter program is nearing the end of its development program and is over 90% complete. It's no secret that the F-35 development program has faced some significant challenges in cost and schedule overruns early in development. After being re-baselined in 2010, the program has been successful in meeting cost and schedule goals. Although F-35 development is scheduled to be completed by October of this year, General Bogdan has noted in previous updates that there remains about 3 to 4 months of schedule risk to completion of the F-35 development program, and additional costs could be incurred. In terms of oversight, the subcommittee remains concerned about the costs associated with closing out the F-35 development program, the majority of the program to potentially execute a block buy for fiscal years 2018 through 2020, and determining whether more efficient program management can help accelerate the initial operational test and evaluation program. We expect to gain a better understanding of these important oversight issues today. During our hearing last July on fifth-generation fighters, General Herbert Hawk Carlisle stressed that fourth-generation aircraft still plays a significant role in the near term in assessing fighter capability and inventory concerns, since we have few operational fifth-generation fighters. He also noted that the importance of fifth-generation fighters, and I'm going to quote him, says, "The role of our fourth-generation fighters will diminish over time due to two main reasons. The first is they will age out and be replaced by more capable F-35s. But more pressingly, our fourth-generation fighters are more increasingly unable to operate in highly contested environments where advanced air defense systems render them ineffective. Given current fiscal constraints, the military services are being forced to prioritize between building capacity in fourth-generation tactical aircraft inventory to help mitigate some of the immediate readiness burdens on the current force, or trying to accelerate needed fifth-generation tactical aircraft capability. For national security purposes, it's not a question of one or the other, which I hope we'll discuss today. It really is an answer of we need both, and we need more of both. In closing, there have been several reports and comments in regards to the President's concern for the need to lower the cost of the F-35. Affordability of this program has always been an oversight issue, both for this committee and Congress. We welcome the President's attention and the effect that this may have on the overall program and its cost. I'm looking forward to working with the new administration and the Department of Defense to continue to explore ways to reduce costs in this program and other defense programs. I will now turn to my ranking member, Ms. Tsongas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'd like to commend you for picking such an important topic to begin our slate of hearings in the 115th Congress. For over two decades, the Department of Defense, the military services, and industry have worked to produce the most advanced fighter aircraft in history. As with any project of its size, scope, and complexity, the F-35 deserves appropriate congressional oversight. And I look forward to speaking with today's witnesses to get a better understanding of how the Joint Program Office and the services plan to move forward with the program's development and testing. With that, I yield back, and I look forward to your testimony.
General Bogdan, you'll be opening the hearing.
Thank you, sir. Chairman Turner, Ranking Member Tsongas, and distinguished members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to address this committee regarding the F-35 Lightning II program. I wish to keep my remarks short in order to allow more time for your questions. I'm happy to be joined today by three distinguished senior officers who represent our U.S. service warfighters on the F-35 program. These gentlemen are my customers, as well as 11 other allied nations who depend on the success of the F-35 program. As the program executive officer and program director, I work for them, as well as the taxpayers, to ensure that we are delivering an affordable, reliable, sustainable, and effective F-35 weapon system. The F-35 program today is much different and improved than it was 5 years ago when I first became the program executive officer. Today, the fleet of F-35s has grown to exceed 210 airplanes and has surpassed 73,000 flight hours. The weapon system is considered operational and combat ready by both the U.S. Air Force and U.S. Marine Corps. It is also forward deployed today in Iwakuni, Japan for the U.S. Marine Corps and operated in Israel and Italy by those F-35 customers. The three major areas of the program, development, production, and sustainment, have made significant and solid progress since the last time I appeared before you on this committee. Let me quickly address each. With respect to development and flight test, we are now within a year of completing this phase of the program and delivering the full capability of the F-35 as it was envisioned in 2001 when this program began. Excuse me. Despite what you might hear, the development and flight test program is on track to finish within a few months and within the cost caps put in place 6 years ago in 2011 when the program was rebaselined. We are also making a smooth transition from development to a lean follow-on modernization program that has incorporated many of the lessons learned from the original F-35 program and other modernization programs such as the F-22 and the FNA-18 Super Hornet. However, completing the development program is not without risk. I've often said that the mark of a good program is not that it has no problems, but rather it discovers problems, implements solutions, and improves the weapon system while keeping the program on track. I believe we've been doing that for years now and will continue to do so. I'm prepared to discuss during our Q&A some of the challenges and risks we face today moving forward on the development program, such as our software, our Autonomic Logistics Information System, known as ALICE, mission data files, various C model, unique issues, and any other risks and challenges you might want me to address. As for production, we delivered 46 of 53 airplanes last year. We were short on delivery of those airplanes due to a problem with peeling and deteriorating insulation inside the F-35A fuel tanks. The problem is now resolved, with all affected aircraft in the field repaired, and the aircraft deliveries from our production line are recovering. We will be back on production schedule by this summer. We're also in the middle of the largest ramp up in the program's history, going from 61 aircraft in Lot 9 to over 160 aircraft in Lot 13, a nearly threefold increase in just 4 years. I would also like to thank the Congress for the additional 17 F-35s that the services procured in FY15 and 16 as a result of congressional plus-ups. The government industry team remains laser-focused on driving the cost of buying F-35s down. We continue to see lot-over-lot price reductions, with the latest lot of aircraft, Lot 10, being about 7.5% less expensive than the previous Lot 9. Today, an F-35A model costs approximately $94.5 million. It is the first time that an F-35 has been below $100 million to purchase. We believe we are on track to continue to reduce the price of the F-35 such that an FY19 with an engine, including all fees, the F-35A model will cost between $80 and $85 million. As part of this reduction, we've initiated a block buy strategy for our foreign partners and an economic order quantity contracting strategy for the U.S. services. I'm prepared to discuss this strategy with you as there has been much misinformation about what this block buy and EOQ strategy really is. If the strategy is implemented, it will save approximately $2 billion over the three lots of airplanes from FY18, 19, and 20. Finally, the last major portion of the program, our logistics and sustainment area, is rapidly growing and accelerating. We are building a capability to globally maintain and repair F-35s in the Pacific, European, and North American regions. The ramp-up of depot capacity and heavy maintenance repair of components, warehousing, and our global supply chain is progressing well, with all of our allies contributing to this global stand-up. We'll also be adding 14 new operating locations around the world in the next 3 years, making the F-35 weapon system a truly global capability. I'm also prepared today to discuss in detail the two tasks that the F-35 was directed by Secretary Mattis. The first one is a Joint Program Office task to conduct a comprehensive review of all affordability initiatives we have implemented thus far in the program and to present future cost reduction initiatives we intend on implementing across the program in the future. The second task is primarily a Navy task, and it is to determine an appropriate, affordable, complementary mix of F-35Cs and advanced Super Hornets on the Navy's aircraft carriers in the future. I look forward to answering your questions about these two tasks. In summary, the F-35 program is on a good trajectory today. The fleet is rapidly expanding, and we're flying F-35s in the United States, Italy, Japan, and Israel as we speak. The development program is nearing completion within the cost and schedule boundaries put in place in the 2011 re-baseline, and the program is also continuing to successfully ramp up production and accelerating the stand-up of our global enterprise. As always, our number one overarching priority is to continue to drive cost out of this program while we deliver the full capability to our warfighters. We will continue to execute this program with integrity, discipline, and transparency, and I hold myself and my team accountable for the outcomes on this program. Our team recognizes the great responsibility we've been given to provide the foundation of future U.S. and allied fighter capability for decades to come. We also recognize that someday your sons and daughters, your grandsons and granddaughters, may take this airplane into harm's way to defend our freedom and our way of life. It's a responsibility we never, ever forget. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss the program, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, General Davis.
Chairman Turner, Ranking Member Tsongas, distinguished members of the House Armed Services Subcommittee on Tactical and Air Land Forces, and other distinguished members, thank you for your continued support. All of us appreciate the opportunity to testify on the F-35 Lightning program. I'm sure you're aware, the F-35B and the F-35C remain a top acquisition priority for the Marine Corps. We can't get into those airplanes fast enough. You have my statement already printed out. I just returned last night from Yuma, Arizona, spent 3 days out there with our fleet forces and our Nav Air team, talking about how we improve the readiness of the legacy platforms out there. We're making progress out there. But I will tell you that on average, Marine Corps tactical aviation is some of the oldest in the Department of Defense, if not the oldest. F-18s and Harriers, on average, 22 years old. These airplanes have performed brilliantly. We're extracting maximum value out of each and every one of them, but they're old airplanes. And we intend to extract maximum value, but it's getting harder and harder each and every day. Also out there in Yuma, that's kind of the epicenter of Marine Corps F-35 operations right now, too. And bottom line, so while that's taking place inside, outside, both day and night, the F-35s are ahead flying, training. And I'll tell you, the pilots and the folks that are working on those airplanes and getting into those airplanes know, as I know, and I'm becoming increasingly convinced that we have a game changer, a war winner on our hands. The United States Marine Corps is our nation's force and readiness. We hold that responsibility to be a sacred responsibility. When the nation's most ready, or least ready, we need to be most ready. And that means not just against a low-end threat, against the high-end threat. In an overmatched fight, we're convinced, I'm convinced, we absolutely positively have to have this airplane in numbers as quickly as we can. I'll tell you that I've been flying Marine Corps airplanes. I've been in the Marine Corps for 37 years, flying Marine tactical airplanes for 36. I've commanded our weapons school. I've not seen anything like this in the entire history of my time. I've flown AV-8s, I've flown F-18s. I still occasionally fly the F-5. Not very well, but I still fly a little bit. This airplane is changing things in a big way, whether it's at Red Flag, where the chief of staff of the Air Force says the airplane F-35B is supportive of an Air Force operation, turn in a decisive effort. The exchange rates, I read the blogosphere, 15 to 1 the last of Red Flag. I get seen the blogosphere, the retired Marine generals writing, that can't be true. I'm like, it is true. I'm not challenging that whatsoever. I see that in the last three WTI classes we ran at Mach 1. The scenarios we could never get in before, that our airplanes got shot down, and more importantly, because we're always going to try to get in there and deliver that bomb for the Marine on the ground, in simulated exercise, we lost a lot of airplanes in scenarios that were fourth-generation airplanes, and putting in both our Prowlers, our Hornets, and our Harriers. That changed when we brought in fifth-generation airplanes, specifically F-35. We're achieving astounding results in the highest threat scenarios, and that across the range of military operations fight with the F-35. It is changing things in a very decisive way. We've taken it to deploy to the 29 Palms and lived hard, which is what we expect our Marines to do. We've taken it on board amphibious ships. The last time we decided to see what we could do, we sent as many as we could afford to send with a deployment going on to Japan. We sent 12 airplanes to go aboard the USS America. Fantastic. We took out V-22s, AH-1 Zulus, and Yankees and operated out there for 3 or 4 days. It was seamless, and it was exceptional, and a really great effort out there on the part of the team. Last year we sent airplanes over to the Transland across to the United Kingdom, and just in January we spent our first operational squadron, VMFA 121, which is the first squadron to declare initial operating capability, to Japan. So that squadron is in Japan now, and if you read the press reports, they're not only just in Japan, they were at Okinawa supporting our Marines on the ground and operating out there. So they're already operating fifth-generation Stovall airplanes in the Pacific. Really inspiring. And the last thing I'll tell you, we just had a what we call a Marine Division Tactics class down in Beaufort, South Carolina. And we had a scenario out there. It was a 20-v-8, 20 versus 8. 20 bad guys against 8 good guys. In those 8 good guys were 4 Marine F-35Bs. What that was interesting, basically, that the 20 guys had a very bad day. I'll leave it at that. The 8 had a very good day. They all came home. But it was most important in the debrief, one of the pilots talking about all the kills they made, and the majority of the kills came from the F-35s. He was very clear. He's amazing presence. He talked about what he did, and when they found out who he was a Cat 1 student in our fleet replacement squadron. This was his graduation exercise. We have brand new guys coming out of the training pipeline flying this airplane that are operating like Marine veterans that have 3 or 4 years experience. I've never seen anything like it. I thought I'd want to tell you about that today. That means we have an airplane out here in its beginning of its life that's going to grow and get more and more capability. I can't get those airplanes in the fleet fast enough to replace our F-18s and our Harriers, and I look forward to your support, and I'll answer any and all of your questions. Thank you.
Admiral Miller.
Chairman Turner, Ranking Member Tsongas, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today to discuss how the Navy and Marine Corps' F-35C with fifth-generation capabilities and fully integrated into our carrier air wings will meet and exceed warfighting needs. Along with our Marine Corps and Air Force team, the F-35C remains a naval aviation acquisition priority. The F-35C will form the backbone of Navy air combat superiority for decades to come, complementing the tactical fighter fleet with a dominant, multi-role, fifth-generation aircraft capable of projecting U.S. power and deterring potential adversaries. The carrier air wing of the future must rely on the capacity and capabilities of both fourth- and fifth-generation aircraft. The F-35C provides unique capabilities that cannot be matched by modernizing fourth-generation aircraft. Stealth technology and advanced integrated systems enable the F-35C to counter rapidly evolving air-to-air and surface-to-air threats. Fifth-generation advancements shift focus from kinematics to information collection and dissemination in real-time battle space, enabling us to break enemy kill chains while facilitating our own. Coupled with the proven capabilities and capacities of a continually improving and relevant carrier air wing, the F-35C greatly enhances a carrier strike group's battle space awareness, lethality, and survivability to prevail in a high-end conflict. The fiscal year 17 President's budget supports the F-35C procurement to complete system development demonstration, initial operations test and evaluation, initial operational capability and to transition squadrons on a timeline that supports the first operational deployment on USS Carl Vinson in fiscal year 21. The Navy also has a robust sustainment plan that supports operating this new aircraft and properly training maintenance crews and carrier air wing aviators. Ultimately, the F-35C integrated and interoperable in the carrier air wing, the carrier strike group of the future will be more lethal, survivable, and able to accomplish the entire spectrum of mission sets to include immediate response to high-end threats. The Navy remains dedicated to a capabilities-focused approach as we evolve the carrier air wing and carrier strike group of the future. The dynamic security environment requires the speed, endurance, flexibility, and autonomous nature of the carrier strike group. The nation needs the tremendous capabilities of the F-35C on its carrier flight decks. The aircraft's stealth characteristics, long-range combat identification, and ability to penetrate threat envelopes while fusing multiple information sources into a coherent picture will transform the joint and coalition view of the battlefield. I agree with my colleague, General Davis. We've already seen it in practice so far. The F-35C's capability will provide decision superiority to the nation's warfighters to ensure that if deterrence fails, the United States can conduct and will conduct decisive combat operations to defeat any enemy. Thank you again for your continued support, and I look forward to any and all of your questions.
General Harris.
Chairman Turner, Ranking Member Tsongas, and distinguished members of the Tactical Air and Land Forces Subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to continue our fifth generation discussion for fighter capabilities. When I spoke to you last at a field hearing in Dayton, we talked about the fifth generation capabilities, and now I intend to offer to you a glimpse of how the F-35A is performing and meeting our Air Force requirements as we continue to develop and procure this stealthy fighter. Since we last met, the F-35A completed a trip to the United Kingdom and also very recently successfully completed a deployment to Nellis Air Force Base and participated in Exercise Red Flag Alaska. While we look forward to the fielding of the final system development and demonstration Block 3F aircraft, our operational pilots and maintainers at Hill Air Force Base are pleased with the F-35A in the Block 3I configuration. General Carlisle in August of last year declared the unit IOC, and the team has been performing remarkably well. Even though the Block 3I is an interim capability, the performance continues to excite the pilots. The pilots I've spoken with are pleased with the way the aircraft handles and the destruction of targets, both in the air and on the ground, continues to be at rates higher than expected. The maintainers continue to produce combat-ready aircraft at impressive levels. The team deployed 13 F-35As and executed 207 of 226 planned sorties with zero maintenance non-deliveries and maintained greater than a 90% mission capable rate. 19 sorties were mission canceled by the Red Flag staff for weather, not due to F-35 limitations. That is simply an awesome effort. And as you know, most fighter pilots will tend to exaggerate their claims and capabilities, but this morning's report with the 15-to-1 kill ratio is actually a little bit off the mark. Looking at the numbers, it was 20-to-1. The airplane is doing exactly what we need it to do. The F-35A fleet is growing and will become a dominant force in our fifth generation arsenal, deterring potential adversaries and assuring both our allies and our partners at the same time. Thank you for having me back. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, gentlemen, and thank you for the report on the progress that's being made with the F-35. As I mentioned in my opening statement, President Trump has entered into the discussion on the cost of the F-35 and has raised the issue of the F-18. General Bogdan, you have spoken to the President directly and several times on this issue. We all know that the F-35 can do the job of the F-18. The F-18 cannot do the job of the F-35, but you don't always need an F-35 to do the job. So the question as to that mix and how we proceed is an issue that I know, General Bogdan, you've been involved in, and Admiral Miller. Secretary of Defense Mattis has tasked you and others with the prospects of putting together a report as to that comparison. As we look to that issue, it certainly goes to the operational capabilities of the F-35, the environment that the F-35 and the F-18 enter into, but we certainly want to underscore the need for ensuring that we do acquire all of the F-35s that we need and that we have the F-18 capability. General Bogdan, you want to tell us how those conversations go? And I just want to interject for a minute. There's been some media reports that the president has called you directly and that you know, that's breaking the chain of command. I know, having spoken to you personally, you're certainly up to that task, and I'm glad that he picks up the phone and calls you. We look forward to your answer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you for giving me an opportunity to address this directly. The first time I met the president-elect was in mid-December at Mar-a-Lago in Florida with a number of other senior DOD military officers. That discussion centered around the F-35 and the presidential aircraft. Following that meeting, I had two follow-up phone conversations with the president-elect. One of them was on the 9th of January. One of them was on the 17th of January. On the 9th of January, that phone call was just myself and President-elect Trump. On the 17th of January, the phone call was myself, President-elect Trump, and Mr. Muhlenberg, the CEO of Boeing. It's important to understand that the discussions that we had were all pre-decisional. There were no decisions made during those conversations, and it was my belief that President-elect Trump at the time was attempting to gain more information about the F-35 and its affordability, trying to gain more information about the F-35's capabilities relative to the Super Hornet, and to gain more information about the presidential aircraft replacement program. In fact, the questions that he asked and the answers that I gave were the foundation of the tasks that came out from Secretary Mattis 2 weeks ago, which are ongoing right now. The first of those being, what are you doing to ensure the affordability of the F-35 now and in the future? And how can we ensure that the taxpayers are getting a best value for their dollar? And the second of those tasks was a Navy task about the mix, the complementary mix of Super Hornets, advanced Super Hornets, and F-35Cs on the deck of an aircraft carrier, where he was asking for a comparison of the capabilities. Those tasks are ongoing. They're not completed yet. We have yet to report the answers to the Secretary of Defense. I'm sure as soon as we report those tasks to him, he will then relay them to the appropriate folks in the administration.
Admiral Miller, great segue then to you. I know from General Bogdan you can't report on the outcome, but you can give us some understanding of the elements that are being looked at. You know, our concern is one of ensuring that in having that complementary mix, that we don't disadvantage ourselves, that we don't underestimate what future challenges will be, and diminish what our overall assets will be in fighter aircraft. Could you give us some understanding of what elements that you're looking at?
Yes, sir. It's interesting when you see how the task came and you hear the word competing. That's not how the Navy views it. The Navy views our F-18 Super Hornet and its fourth-gen capacity and the capabilities that come with the exquisite F-35C as complementary. And our view, and per our 30-year aviation plan, is that we end up with a carrier air wing mix. We grow to a mix that provides two squadrons of F-35Cs and two squadrons of Super Hornets. We feel that that mix, that complementary capacity of the Super Hornet and the capability of the F-35C is going to handle us well in the near term and as we continue to grow that capability into the far term. Now, both of these aircraft, just like every weapon system that we always have, continues to have a modernization program. So the F-35C follow-on modernization program addresses that for the F-35. F-18s are not unique in that regard. They also have a modernization effort. So just as do our ships and existing airplanes within the air wing. We look at it, Chairman Turner, you mentioned earlier about the readiness hearings where the vice chiefs were out and talk, and you see the extent where we sit right now. We have a shortfall in the Navy on our carrier flight decks, in our strike fighter. We call it strike fighter inventory management. So that mix and what we need to buy now and how we portray that throughout the fit-up and in the following years will be something that we're going to take seriously, so we have to address our near-term issues as well as make sure that our warfighting needs are met.
Thank you. Well, this is a program that everyone has looked at, both issues of cost and time. General Bogdan, this program since 2010 has been on cost and on schedule. We're, however, looking forward at, and in doing so, seeing that we have concerns once again of increased costs and increased time. We look at finishing the program. We understand that the Director of Operational Test and Evaluation indicated that up to $1 billion of additional funding could be required to complete the F-35 system design and development, which is currently scheduled to be completed in October of this year. In addition, we looked at initial operating test and evaluation. The belief was that the F-35 would be available operational August 2017. Now we look at those dates, might slip 2018 or even early 2019. General Bogdan, can you tell us where we are and what needs to be done so we can get back on track?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The portrayal that we need another $1 billion to finish the SDD program is inaccurate. Today, as it stands, the budget for the SDD program in 17, 18, 19, and a very small amount in 20, is short about $532 million. And let me explain where that $532 million shortfall comes from. First, in 2014, the Department of Defense removed $100 million of RDT&E funding from the F-35 program to pay for higher priority things in the department. That money was never paid back. So that would be $100 million that we would just expect to get paid back just to get us to the baseline budget we have. There are also $165 million worth of new requirements that have been added to the program since 2013. Some of those include the need for a deployable ALIS. Some of them include some cybersecurity enhancements we needed to make to our offboard systems, like our mission planning system, as well as the airplane. Those were mandated from OSD and from the cybersecurity folks. If you add those requirements, which were not paid for at the time we executed them, that's another $165 million of added requirements that normally would have been paid for in the 13, 14, 15 timeframe when we were executing them, that were not, because the department asked us at that time to use management reserve to pay for those added requirements. That adds up to $265 million. The remaining $267 million to get you to the 532 is a result of unexpected results we've had in our flight testing. We had an engine fire back 2.5 years ago, and we had to fix the engine. We had 3i software stability issues last year that required us to go in and fix that stability. We've had problems with the 3i and 3f software in terms of clutter and ghosting and things like that. We had to fix those issues too. That's the added $267 million, totaling the 532 that I need to finish SDD. But here's the real important point about this. Every penny of that $532 million is coming from inside the F-35 program with funding that I already have. It comes from management reserve. It comes from fee that our industry partners have not earned and will not earn. And it comes from negotiated savings that we have when we negotiate contracts in excess of the budget that we've been given. So from our warfighter's perspective, I am not going back and asking them for a penny more than what they have already put into the program, because the direction from the department has been, General Bogdan, you will find the money for that $532 million inside the program, and we have.
General Bogdan, you just mentioned 2014 and you lost dollars. We've had an environment of defense cuts that have affected modernization and also has affected readiness, sequestration being one of the big effects of that, that has had devastating effects on our military. But I want to ask you for a moment if you could embellish the discussion that you just had on defense cuts, because so many times We get into the false discussion of, well, if the prices are high, we could just buy less. But the reality is that buying less means that the costs go up. I mean, you have a fixed cost base that you have to maintain for the production line and equipment, and the marginal cost, again, the additional planes that you buy actually overall lowers the cost. Could you give us your thoughts on that so that we can have people understand a little bit about what your challenges are?
Yes, sir. What you were mentioning there is a phenomenon in the acquisition world known as a death spiral. And it goes something like this. If I'm going to buy a certain number of airplanes, and each of those airplanes costs a certain amount of money, and we budget for that, if budget is removed so you cannot buy that many airplanes, and you have to buy less airplanes, the price of each of those fewer airplanes goes up. And then the future airplanes that you're going to buy also goes up, so the budget that you had doesn't go as far, and that death spiral gets you to a point where ever-decreasing budgets result in ever-decreasing quantities, which result in ever-increasing unit prices on the airplane, and you get to a point where you're buying a whole lot of airplanes, very few airplanes, for a whole lot of money. This program has not experienced that yet, and will not experience that, because if we continue on the ramp rate that the warfighters need, the price of the airplane will continue to come down. But when you take money away from the production program, every airplane in the future, the price then goes up on this program.
Thank you, General. I think that it's a very important part of the discussion as we look at the mix of the F-35 and the F-18. We don't want to say, well, just buy more 18s, because then we can lower the cost of the F-35, because in the end, if you reduce the production of F-35, you could result in spending more on both and getting less. With that, I'll turn to Nikki Songs.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate the testimony today, just highlighting the extraordinary potential capabilities of the F-35 and how it is a game changer. But we all still wrestle with the costs, and that's particularly true in the constrained environments in which we have been operating. And General Bogdan, I appreciate that as there are additional costs that have been identified, and you reference the $532 million that are available, so that it isn't going to require any new funding for the SDD phase. I just wonder, if that $532 million comes from inside the program, does that mean you routinely have half a billion dollars, just extra money available? And what else could we do with that money were this SDD phase didn't need these additional funds? Could we not buy more planes?
It's a great question, ma'am. The $265 million of the 532 was simply payback for new requirements and, like I said, for the money that was taken away. The $267 million, clearly, if I can find that money inside the program and I didn't have to apply it to finish the SDD program, it could have been used for something else. The normal procedure that I have when we do negotiate better contracts and when we do have fee that industry hasn't earned is I turn to the warfighters and to the services, and I say to them, what would you like me to do with that money? Would you like me to buy more airplanes? Would you like me to keep it inside the program to pay for new requirements? Or would you like me to give that money back so you can use it in other parts of your defense budget, not F-35 related? In this instance, when I identified the funds inside, we went back to the services and we went back to the department, and the decision was made, leave the money inside the program so that you can finish the SDD program. But you are correct, ma'am. That extra money could be used for other things. And unfortunately, it has to be used to complete SDD, the development program, because we had unexpected results, engine fires, and things that we didn't expect to have happen that we simply needed to fix.
But it certainly does highlight that there are large sums available when needed within the program. And I think my question really is about that fact. But I'd actually like to go on to something else. You have referenced that the $1 billion estimate of potential future costs is inaccurate. And I'm just curious how confident you are that you won't be coming back here in the next round. Again, suddenly the numbers have moved. How confident are you?
Ma'am, I'm very confident. I've been running this program for 5 years now, and I have never once gone back to the services or to you to ask for more money. This is the first time, as we get near the end of SDD, where I have shown and been transparent about a budget shortfall. However, given the fact that we negotiate large lots of airplanes, for example, Lot 11 is going to be somewhere in the order of above $10 billion worth. If we can negotiate better deals for the price of those airplanes, then that money that I save in negotiating is the money that I'll turn to the services and turn to the department and ask, what would you like me to do with that?
Well, I appreciate your confidence. I'd like to ask another question now. The Director of Operational Test and Evaluation estimates that a significant delay in starting initial operational test and evaluation due to delays in getting aircraft modified and upgraded to the required standards. In your testimony, you mentioned a written testimony, you mentioned a desire to start initial operational test and evaluation earlier than currently planned, but with fewer test aircraft, and you cite several reasons for wanting to do that. A long-standing testing standard for operational tests are to ensure that fully capable production representative aircraft are used, similar to those that will be operated by frontline service members. If DOD does go forward with your plan, it appears that the testing would not be done with the previously agreed upon number of aircraft and with aircraft that are not fully upgraded with the latest combat capabilities. Do you agree that the testing will tell us all more if it is done as currently planned rather than taking shortcuts? Why cut corners?
Ma'am, I can assure you that my program office and I would never, ever cut corners when it comes to delivering combat capability, because young men and women are going to put their lives on the line for that. However, having said that, it is a true statement that the original program of record was supposed to start initial operational testing in August of 2017. One of the requirements to start that full operational testing was to have 23 production representative F-35s ready to go. I will not have 23 full production representative airplanes ready to go in August. In fact, by February of 2018, I'll only have 18 of those airplanes in a fully production representative configuration. What I have asked the OT community to look at is an incremental start to operational testing with those 18 airplanes, and then over the next few months, add the additional airplanes to get them to the 23. So the 18 airplanes that they would incrementally start OT with would be fully production representative and would be fully representative of the combat capability of the airplane. There's a number of reasons why incrementally starting makes sense from a program perspective. One, every 6 months I delay OT costs another $30 million. So it saves the department and the enterprise money. Second, the sooner I can get the feedback from the operational testers, who are the experts, the faster I can fix any problems that they find. And given that we're producing over 100 airplanes a year on the production line, anytime I can find something wrong with the airplane and fix it sooner means I can cut that into the production line quicker, and I'm not going to be producing airplanes that later on have to be retrofitted and fixed. It is not my choice to start OT. What I do is I provide the resources to the OT community and they decide. All I've asked them to do is take a look at a way to potentially incrementally begin operational test, not such that at the end of OT or in the middle of OT they wouldn't have everything they need, but just to start it a little bit sooner with less than the full complement of airplanes.
But this program does have a long history of discovering problems in developmental testing, and it has added many years to the program, so I just think it makes more sense to be more conservative when it comes to operational testing. And with that, I yield back.
To our Vice Chair, Paul Cook.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I had the pleasure of visiting Luke Air Force Base out in the desert, and I came in there and I had a number of questions which have been addressed One was the helmet, the computer, the flight suit, the whole works, the cost overruns. And I got a chance to talk to a lot of the pilots. And I was really, really impressed with the pilots. The pilots, you know, I don't want to go, they actually were nice to me. Here's an infantry guy. They explained the acronyms. They used one-syllable words. It was really good. And got a great feeling. The only hang-up I had was talking to the maintenance folks. And I am scared to death of the maintenance trail, just like I am with the Hornets and the problems and everything else like that. General Davis, I think you made the point about, you know, the fleet is getting old planes. The chairman and I were out in 29 Palms. We were watching tanks. We were watching Harriers. And the planes weren't not... They were not as old as I was, but they're getting close. And every time I start talking maintenance, I get, you know, kind of a hesitation whether we're going to have this. And the boneyards, and I won't go through the whole thing. I want to get that feeling that, okay, I am pot committed to the F-35, but God Almighty, we got to have everything in place to make sure that maintenance trail, the parts and everything else, so that we don't have a system that's C4 or a C3. Can you address that, anybody? General Bogdan?
Hey, sir, thanks for visiting the Luke, and thanks for visiting 20 Palms, God's country, and in my world, the aviators better be nice to the infantry officers. We'll be without a job. That's why we exist. You know that in the Marine Corps.
How come there's no band on the front of the plane? No,
yes, sir.
Okay.
Right. It's all good. We are very, you know, we underfunded the spares accounts in this airplane early on, and we're living that right now. So we've actually helped, we've basically invested forward, tried to get additional help. We've asked for the spare parts to be put into the unfunded priority list to get that back up to speed. This airplane is performing very well if it's got the spare parts, and if there's no spare part for an airplane when it's down, whether it's Air Force, Navy, or Marine Corps, the Marines, the airmen, the sailors will get it, but they'll take it off another airplane. That's debilitating. That's the wrong way to do business. So the spares accounts need to be funded. And I think you need to hold us account to make sure that they are, that the airplane comes in, the spares comes in there as well. And I think we talked about how impressed we are with the pilots. You know, I've got three squadrons right now of F-35s. The training squadron's got British, Royal Navy, Royal Air Force maintainers in there as well. They're phenomenal.
General, since we're at the subject of 29 Palms, the Expeditionary Airfield out there, you know, I've asked this question three times, and that the F-35 is going to operate off of that field there, which is very austere. It's sand. It's the dreaded FOD. It's everything else. And I've referred in previous committee to be at a Camp Lejeune or Lejeune years ago where Lyman Road, you had to have a street sweeper to make sure there was no dust on the road. That's an austere combat environment. And is that F-35 going to be able to operate out of that when the wind and the dirt and the sand and everything else, just like it is in the Middle East?
Sir, we did. We went up there and operated, did very well. I think that what we're finding right now is the F-35B with this engine is less FOD, less susceptible to FOD than our Harriers are. We've flown the F-35B now 26,000 hours. We've been up there to the strip. We've been to the expeditionary strips out there. We do hot combat loads out of Laguna Airfield and flying out of Yuma, which historically is a very high FOD environment for our Harriers. We've had four FOD events in 26,000 flight hours. That's 0.00016. That's really low. So I think we need to be careful about where we go and what we do. But we're learning. Like one of the things we learned is we would come into the pad like we did in the Harrier at 100 feet, cross the pad at 100 feet and let down. We're crossing out 150, so we're learning as we go. So we're adapting our TTPs a bit, our tactics, techniques, and procedures. But we're finding a much lower prevalence for FOD on this airplane we did in the Harrier. I think we're going to operate like the Marine Corps does with 1 foot ashore and 1 foot at sea, and we haven't had any FOD events in any of our shipboard environments with the F-35B to date.
Thank you, General. I yield back.
Jackie Rosen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for being here today, and thank you for your service. You know, I represent a district in southern Nevada. It's less than a dozen miles away from Nellis Air Force Base, which, of course, is home to the U.S. Air Force Warfare Center, the largest advanced air combat training mission in the world. And one of Nellis's primary missions include the testing of the nation's most advanced aircraft and weapon systems. Earlier this month, we were privileged to have the F-35, the advanced red flag exercises, right there at Nellis. It's great for the people who live there. We see the planes flying around. It gives everybody a great chance to see some of the things you're doing. But I'd like you to discuss how the F-35 performed in these exercises, what level of confidence you have in the test, and as a former systems analyst and computer programmer, I'm specifically concerned about your software capabilities, its susceptibilities to hackers, and their ability to disrupt or disable an aircraft. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Ma'am, thank you for the support for Nellis. It is an awesome location and certainly one that the Air Force enjoys to talk about because there is so much going on that is on this high-end environment. And the exercise red flag that I spoke at, that the squadron deployed to, they performed extremely well. The maintenance was not an issue. The airplanes went out, and as I said, the pilots were excited. They had 145 air-to-air kills, which is the first time the F-35A has participated in a red flag. Versus seven losses, and all of those losses were in a within visual environment. In that, it means they weren't seen on the radar; they just were seen passing by. Mm-hmm. And the way we run our red flags, because this was a high-end red flag, there was significantly more adversaries than there typically are, and these adversaries were employing electronic countermeasures and had advanced tactics in an integrated air defense. So not just the air, but also the threats on the ground. And the F-35 is one of the few. Only fifth-generation type airplane can participate and fly inside of those threat environments. We would normally build an entire package of fourth-gen fighters to try and attack one of these sites, yet the F-35 was able to operate inside of those threats and had significant successes. They employed 51 simulated weapons against those SAM sites with the success of killing 49 of them throughout the exercise, which is a huge number, much better than what we would have done in our fourth gen. And they were 92% successful on their heavyweight weapons delivery, which is far exceeding where we expected to be this early in the development phase. So it's going well.
Thank you.
Ma'am, to address your question about the software and the vulnerability, I'd like to have you think of the weapon system in two pieces. The first piece is the airplane itself. Mm-hmm. I can assure you, and we can't talk about it here very much, but I can assure you that the ability of this airplane to withstand software vulnerabilities from the airplane perspective is unmatched in the Department of Defense. We knew when we started designing this airplane in 2001, it would be exported to other nations and other places. So we built in the special ways to protect the airplane. I have very, very, very little concern about the airplane itself. I have a much greater concern about the what we call the off-board systems, the maintenance system and the mission planning system, because those systems connect to other networks in DOD and with our partners, and all of those networks become vulnerable. But what I will tell you is we've undergone over 150 vulnerability and penetration tests on our maintenance system and on our off-board mission planning system, and we found some things, and we're fixing them. Some of that money I talked about that I have to spend extra goes to the very heart of the cybersecurity issues that we've discovered that we have to improve for our off-board systems. What I can tell you is this is not something that the department is taking lightly. We have the best experts in the department trying to penetrate the system and showing us how to fix it, and we are in the process of fixing it. And in another forum, ma'am, I'd like to be able to show you and tell you a little more about that.
Thank you. I'd look forward to that, and I yield back my time. Thank you.
Martha McSally.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, for your testimony. I was at Heritage Flight at Davis-Monthan this weekend, climbed up the ladder of the F-35, talked to the pilots and maintenance, and it was great. great to have it there. It's an amazing capability that we do need a fifth-generation fighter to, as fast as possible, as you've all testified. My focus, as you all know, is on the low end of the spectrum and it replacing CAS and combat search and rescue capabilities where you need continuous coverage, loiter time, lethality, survivability from small arms and those types of things. One of the important capabilities for that is a gun. And so I've seen in some of the reports some challenges with the accuracy of the gun, the gun sight. So General Bogdan, can you give an update on what's going on with the gun and testing and the way ahead?
Yes, ma'am. We're in the process of qualifying both guns on the A model, which is an internal gun, and on the B and the C model, it's a potted gun underneath the center line of the airplane. We've done ground testing, we've done in-flight testing, and there are fundamentally two issues that we have to address in the coming months of development. The first of those being on the A model, when you shoot the gun, because it is off center from the nose of the airplane, it creates a yaw. And soon as the gun is shot, the nose of the airplane moves. And you know, ma'am, as an experienced fighter pilot, if you want to put the bullets on the target, you need to keep the nose steady.
Exactly.
We know what that problem is. We have the software and flight control fixes in place, and we are testing those as we speak. We will let you know if we need to continue to evolve the software and the flight controls to improve it, but we know what that problem is, and we know how to fix it. The second issue we have is with the heads-up display in the helmet. We don't have a fixed heads-up display. And when you're aiming, and you would know this, but I'll keep it simple, the pipper, which is the little aiming reticle used to put on the target for where you want the bullets to hit, has to be fairly steady. And today, with the movement of the helmet and the movement of the airplane, that pipper is moving around too much.
Right.
We understand that problem also. We understand the feedback loop between the airplane's motion and what's going on with the helmet. So we have those software fixes coded and in the airplane. Whether they prove to be sufficient such that the gun can be fired accurately remains to be seen. Those tests are going to happen this spring and this summer, and we will let you know that. But you are right. We've encountered some issues with the gun, and we need to improve those.
And there's also issues with moving targets, as I understand, and the ability to self-laze versus buddy laze. And as you know, in a continuous CAS scenario, you're often yo-yoing to the tanker as a Sandy or a flight lead. So what's the status of that?
So I'll just briefly talk about that and maybe let my warfighting brothers here discuss it. The original capability to hit a moving target on this airplane was embodied in a weapon that is no longer allowed to be used in our inventory. So we did have a capability that was on the books to hit moving targets. And when that weapon was removed from the U.S. inventory for treaty reasons, we lacked the ability to hit a moving target until our follow-on modernization program, where we will put in a moving target tracking capability with our targeting system. In the interim, the Air Force and the Marine Corps have come to us and said, in the meantime, between now and about 2022 or 23, with that moving target capability, we have another weapon that we'd like you to introduce on the airplane, and I'm going to leave that to...
Yeah, I'm familiar with that, and I appreciate we can follow up on that later. Thanks for the update. My last question is to General Harris, and I agree what Admiral Miller said about the complementary focus of the inventory, and we've had many discussions about it's not the F-35 versus the A-10. I think we need both those capabilities in order to have full spectrum operations. We've included in the NDAA a fly-off for the F-35 and the A-10 as part of the testing and evaluation. And it seems the Air Force has made public statements that the A-10 is going to stick around for a while and maybe there'd be a follow-on light attack aircraft. Is there any discussion to remove the A-10, replacement of the A-10 from the requirements document, to just let the F-35 off the hook for that requirement? That would save resources, that would let the vendor off the hook, and we'd be able to move forward to have a complementary inventory of the F-35 and the A-10 or the follow-on to the A-10.
Yes, ma'am. That's a great question. Thank you. I would expect that the F-35 is still going to be held to the same high requirement of being able to do CAS as a mission, because the Air Force feels that our multi-role fighter of the future needs to be able to do that. Yes, we have determined that we're going to keep the A-10 and some other fourth-gen fighters for the next decades based on our F-35 buy rate. So we have the CAS as a mission, and we expect all of our air-to-ground type airplanes to be able to come.
And I agree, CAS is a mission in the environment that it needs to operate in, but I think, again, removing that specific requirement of replacing the A-10 or in the low end of the spectrum is something I'd really like to follow up with the Air Force on. It would save some resources and allow us to move forward in a complementary way. And I'm out of time, so thanks, thanks, gentlemen.
Chairman, if I could, I'd like, as a Marine, with our bread and butter is close air support, I'd like to answer that, man, if you got a second. I'm a career Heripod, so I'm and I'd actually challenge the F designation on the F-35. This is a F, it's an A for an attack, it's also electronic warfare. And we're seeing that. Our weapons school and our train range manual, there's a small portion of that that's the fighter mission. It's a lot of the attack. What I've found it's different than the A-10 and the Harrier, in that using the sensors on the airplane, we have to do close air support. What I've got now in this airplane, what we have now as a nation in this airplane, is I can do, there's no place where my soldiers or sailors or airmen or Marines are that we can't do close air support. As the CEO of the weapons school, to do CAS and be effective at CAS, you've got to have air superiority. Or at least localized air superiority. This airplane allows you to do that one package. We're doing fighter shots and bomb delivery at the same time. The other thing we're doing is through the weather with the APG 81. It's a picture quality target view for the pilots. And so we had a group out there that was trying to close air support in North Carolina the other day. And they're out there flying, and the forward air controller says, the weather's moved in, I think we have to knock this off, and says, hey, we see the target, let's go.
And so, General, I couldn't agree with you more. I know I'm way over at time. We need that capability, yeah. It's amazing, but we also need to be able to stay on station more than 20 to 30 minutes, have more than 180 bullets, have more than two bombs on station, and be able to survive a direct hit. So we need both, from my perspective, but thank you.
Well, Representative McSally, I want to thank you for your tireless effort to ensure that we have close air support capability and your advocacy for the A-10. It is incredibly important that you bring your expertise, so thank you for that. Turning to Mr. Carbajal.
Thank you, Chairman Turner and Ranking Member Tsongas. Thank you to all our witnesses for coming here today. General Bogdan, I would like to focus on the issue of how we are planning to manage the follow-on modernization program known as Block 4. It is my understanding DOD will not manage Block 4 as a separate and distinct acquisition program, despite it being a major acquisition program with the cost tag of almost $3 billion over the next 6 years. This is of great concern, considering this program has faced significant cost and schedule overruns, and the cost for this program is now reaching $400 billion. The GAO has stated, by managing Block 4 as a separate existing baseline, it will not be subject to statutory regulatory oversight requirements. It does not seem prudent for us to not subject this program to the highest degree of oversight and accountability. General Bogdan, can you help me understand why the department is against establishing Block 4 as a separate acquisition program?
Thank you for that question, Congressman. I'll try and be as clear as I can about it. The department's decision not to create a separate program for the follow-on modernization program has nothing to do with us not wanting to be absolutely transparent in what's going on in that program. It has to do with the administrative burden that's placed on starting a new program versus continuing a previous program and adding the modernization program onto it. All of the documentation, and there's over 100 documents that go along with starting a new acquisition program, all have to be redone and revalidated and re-signed when you start a new program. That administrative burden costs millions of dollars and takes months and months and months to get through the bureaucracy. That is not acquisition reform in my mind. What we have told the Congress we would do, and I will stand here today and tell you again, that when we start the follow-on modernization program, it will be a separate contract, it will have separate earned value management, we will watch it and monitor it as a separate program in our SAR reports to you, and we will include in those SAR reports a separate baseline of the schedule and the cost and the performance of the program as if it were a separate program, just without the moniker of it being a separate program because of that administrative burden. I have worked with the defense committees and your staffs to make sure that your equities in oversight are kept when we do this. Our promise to you is that we will be as transparent as if it were a separate program, because it is billions of dollars. And it is your responsibility to make sure that we're spending those taxpayers' dollars wisely. So my promise to you, Congressman, is when we set this program up, we will set it up with separate reporting, with separate earned value management, with separate SAR reporting, and we will provide the Congress with all the transparency and oversight that you would require as if it were a separate program. We just don't want the DOD's administrative burden of a new program, because that will add 6 months to a year to get started and tens of millions of dollars.
Just to conclude, as a new member of Congress, I am informed that DOD is consistently tardy in getting information timely to Congress. How will you ensure that timely information is provided to Congress, despite that infamous reputation that DOD has?
Congressman, what I will tell you is, if it is the desire of this defense committee or any of the other defense committees to get monthly updates, quarterly updates of our earned value and our cost schedule performance progress on the system, we will do that. We will do that. Instead of the annual selected acquisition report, which comes out once a year, we would more than be willing to provide that data to your staffs or to you on whatever frequency you would like, sir.
Thank you. It's just that having served in the Marine Corps, timelines were very important. So when I hear this about DOD, it kind of blows my mind.
Sir, I will tell you, having the program office here in D.C. and me being able to come up here and see you and the defense committees makes that delay in the information flow a lot shorter, much to my chagrin sometimes. But I will tell you, our promise is that we will be as transparent as we possibly can, because we do understand the oversight role that your committee and the other committees have.
Thank you. Mr. Gates.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for your service and for being here. I very proudly represent the warfighters who serve at Eglin Air Force Base in Northwest Florida, and we are so proud to have the F-35 bed down there. We've got plenty of ramp space for more, hopefully in the future, and I also am very proud to represent the warfighters who are stationed at NAS Pensacola. And in my community, we know very well what it means to lose a pilot. We know the impact it has on the warfighters, on family members, and on the community at large. And so I was hoping, General Bogdan, that you could speak to the survivability analysis as we look at the F-35 and the F-18. Perhaps you could illuminate what some of the unique survivability features are that we can discuss in this setting for the 35. And then do you have an opinion that you can share now as to the relative survivability for pilots in the 35 to the F-18?
Thank you, Congressman. I'll take the first part of that question, and then I'm going to defer to my warfighters to give you some specific examples of what's gone on in some of the exercises that they've seen where their pilots come back and tell them how survivable this airplane is. So the F-35 itself is survivable across a full spectrum. And in order to shoot down an airplane, you got to do a lot of things, okay? The first thing you got to do is you got to find it. Okay? The second thing you got to do after you find it is you got to fix it in space so you know where it is. The next thing you got to do is you got to track it so you got to know where it's going. The next thing you got to do after that is you got to target it, meaning you've got to be able to know where it's going very, very quickly. And then finally, you have to put a weapon on it, whether it's a weapon that's shot from the air or from the ground. We call that the kill chain. The F-35 can attack every point in that kill chain to remain survivable. It's not just about stealth. The stealth portion is the upfront part of that, where it's hard to find it and fix it in space. But there are other things on this airplane, including electronic warfare, including other weapons, including information that other airplanes can give to you, that at any point in that kill chain, it can be successful in stopping you from shooting down the airplane. So it's just not about the stealth. It's about the fusion of the information. It's about the electronic warfare. It's about our countermeasures in the end game if somebody does shoot something at the airplane. So the airplane is very, very survivable in almost all environments with most threats. Now I will let my warfighter friends tell you about their experiences.
That's good. I'll tell you, it's survivability. It's not just the F-35 aviator, but it's also everybody that there's associated with that. That we don't just have airplanes just to have airplanes. We support folks on the ground. We support our folks fighting ships in any climate place. I'll tell you that this airplane is giving our pilots a decisive advantage. You talk about the 20-0, the 20-1, the 24-0 that we've been enjoying out there at the weapons school. That's the zero means we're not losing these aviators. And it's not just a fighter threat. It's a very high-end SAM threat, which in days gone by would have been, we call it prohibitive interference. And I ran a drill when I was a weapons CO, school CO in Yuma. We lost half the fleet, and we didn't hit any targets. So in a simulation, that's everybody comes back with a long face, talks about how bad the day was. In the real world, they're not coming back. So this is a very survivable airplane. I mean, incredible. The analogy they talk about, and just what General Bogdan talked about, in days gone by when in my youth it was almost like a football game. Every player had their role, running backs, quarterbacks, linebackers, tailbacks. This airplane is more like, it's like a soccer match. Everybody has the opportunity to be the killer. Everybody sees, everybody shares. And frankly, every exercise, whether it's Air Force, Marine Corps, whoever's flying this airplane, embedded in a large package, it makes everybody else more survivable. The next WTI, we're gonna guide for a Marine artillery unit, the Glimmers, give them GPS. We shot, basically working with the Navy, with the Aegis cruiser in the desert simulation out there, but a real missile at a low-flying target out there, shot an Aegis missile with a MADL, and it was beyond a mountain range and direct hit. We tracked a missile going up out of Vandenberg from 300 miles away. It's changing survivability for everybody in a very positive way. We got something new on our hands, and I think it's very positive.
Just to add on to that comment of increasing the survivability of everybody else, a carrier strike group fights in an integrated fashion. So we are mixing in this fifth-gen capability with our F-18EFs, with our E-2, with our Aegis-class cruisers and destroyers, and then the capacity that that brings. And so, yes, F-35 is more survivable. But to the point that General Davis made about increasing that survivability for everybody else, it absolutely does that, because then that it's coupled with the lethality that comes with the entire strike group. We talked earlier about maintenance and training. All of that, when we bring that carrier, this onto our carriers, the entire package, making sure that the maintainers know how to operate it to keep that lethality in the air. To make sure, and we've already put F-35 out in our Top Gun classes out in Fallon. We talked about training out at Nellis, but Nellis and Fallon, that's as equally important, so that our readiness is there when we ask for this capability that it's provided. Thank
you. Mr. Vesey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to ask you a question in relation to a sense of urgency with the development of a fifth-gen fighter. With regard to the F-35, could you elaborate on how close our adversaries are in developing fifth-generation fighters with capabilities that may match or exceed ours? And wanted to specifically ask General Harris.
Perfect. I appreciate the opportunity to respond to that. As we talked almost a year ago, there are several adversaries that are trying to copy our capabilities, and sometimes it's the outer mold line. But what the fifth generation brings to us is also the internal piece. It's not just the stealth. It's the fusion across the weapon system. It's the engines that provide the maneuverability. And we continue to have an advantage, but they are quickly closing that gap. So we are trying to maximize our ability to procure fifth generation airplanes and go from a 100% fourth generation fleet to a significant mix of fifth generation, so that we have the opportunity to operate in these hostile environments against these threats that are catching us faster than we thought they would.
As far as the internal capabilities of the plane, that involves a lot of technology. What are some issues that we may have that would make it hard for us to be able to keep up in regards to that area?
Well, we're looking at the weapons that the airplanes employ, so we not only have to have advances and continued with rapid acquisition of the airframe, but as we build them, we also must continue to update them. So the follow-on modernization program is very important to all the warfighters associated with the F-35. The threats we look at, fifth generation is already making an impact in today's fight. Russia in Syria has deployed an S-400 system that would or could exclude all fourth generation aircraft from there, but because we're flying fifth generation, not yet the F-35, but very soon, we'll have that opportunity. It's the fifth gen that brings our ability to operate within an environment, hold those threats at risk so that we're able to come to the table as a lead, not a near peer, and continue to have America's domination where we need to across the globe.
And kind of in relation to that, I wanted to ask Admiral Miller about U.S. engagement around the globe and where would the F-35 have the most immediate impact today?
Yeah, good question, sir. I appreciate it. Where would it have the most immediate impact today? I will tell you that our carriers are globally deployed. And so today's fight, for the most part, is counterterrorism. And it certainly would contribute there, but that's not the high-end fight where the value of the F-35, we'd see that value. So what is the next trigger point? What's going to cause that carrier strike group to reposition and to find itself against that near-peer threat that General Davis talked about and General Harris talked about? So we build and we bring in this capability for that sort of a threat. So to answer your question on the immediate impact, it certainly would be able to contribute in the fight we have today in Iraq and Syria.
General Davis.
Sir.
If I could, sir, if you watch the hands of time move and things change in the world, we talked about near peer and peer competitors are more closely coming to be a peer competitor. But for the high-end fight, for the low-end fight, an airplane, a fifth-generation airplane is a very effective killing machine in all spectrum. We also have the ability, when we get the 3F capability, to put pylons on this airplane. The Marine Corps has every intention of doing that, and I'll be able to load up the F-35B with 3,000 pounds more ordnance than I can carry an F-18 right now. So we view this, it's a transformer. It can be a fifth-gen airplane for day 0 through 5 when, you know, I've got to bust in for day 5 through 60. I can put pylons on, operate from an amphibious ship, operate from 3,000 foot of tin ashore, and basically go crush the bad guys, provide close air support to the guys on the ground, and do what we've got to do. And then if I have to go move someplace else, go back to a high-end force, or the situation changes, they roll in those missiles, right? And we still have guys on the ground that we've got to support. Bottom line is the F-35 can go back to that low signature airplane very quickly. And with an airplane like in our Block 4, we get small diameter bomb. Now you're carrying 8 SDB-2s internal to the airplane, plus a cannon. It allows you to survive in that high-end threat environment and do close air support. That's the game changer. The airplane can go back and forth and do it all. I think that's the powerful thing we got coming our way.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
I'm going to read the order here so people can understand what the expectation of when the time is for questionings. We've got Banks, Brown, Bishop, Whitman, Langevin. Going to Mr. Banks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And gentlemen, thank you for your service. Thanks for being here today. You've answered a number of questions already. This has been enlightening for a new member of Congress like me. But specifically, I have a question, General Harris, for you about the future of the National Guard, the future of the program for the reserves, for communities like mine, the 122nd Fighter Wing, who might hope one day to pursue the F-35 as a program at our base, at our installation. But more broadly, what does the program look like in the National Guard and the reserves moving forward?
Well, sir, that's a great question. We have, over the last 5 or 6 years, moved the Air Force through some of the concerns we had with our Guard and Reserve, because over the last 2 decades, our Guard and Reserve have been participating at extreme levels, much more than we would expected a while ago for the rapidity of how often they deploy and the capabilities that they bring to the fight. And when you listen to a brief, when you look at the performance, you can't tell the difference between an active guard or reserve. It's all the same. Because of that, we are looking at the bed down of F-35s in the guard and reserve as we go along. So it's not an airplane that's going to flow to the active first and then move to the guard or the reserve. We're already making those bed down decisions now. So as you can see, our next one has already been selected for the guard, and we are now looking at 5 and 6, where those are best going to be placed. They're a part of it. They're involved with us on a daily basis. And specifically units, not every unit is going to get an F-35, but we have some of these that will continue to advance either in the fourth-gen capabilities. We modernize that, and they can participate in small areas and also homeland defense. But then there will be a follow-on to the F-35, whether it's in an air superiority role, complementary to the F-22, as the F-35 is, or that next generation after it may be a sixth generation. So I expect the Guard and Reserve continue to be equal partners with the active duty.
Thank you for your commitment to that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Mr. Brown passes. Mr. Bishop.
Thank you. First of all, I appreciate, Mr. Chairman, you hosting this hearing, as well as gentlemen for showing up to it. That's very kind of you. I'm glad I was able to free my schedule so I could listen to all of this. This is an important issue. However, Mr. Chairman, you don't really have to start at 8 o'clock in the morning for me to free up my schedule. Just a hint for the future. He's not listening. Fine. All right.
I was. I just don't have a response.
Okay. Fine. We'll talk about that later, too. General Bogdan, if I can... I'm on a policy level here. I'm an old history teacher, so the specifics sometimes are mind-boggling. What I'm trying to come up with is simply what our policy decisions ought to be. So if you could just tell me, you know, the recent red flag exercises you had, did the F-35 meet your expectations, or did they exceed those expectations?
I will tell you, Congressman, from a program director's perspective, those results far exceeded my expectations. The idea that 13 airplanes could have a mission capable rate of above 90% and they could fly 207 missions out of 226, and the only missions that they lost were due to weather or other reasons, with none lost to maintenance. At this point in the program, where we only have 200 airplanes out there and we only have 73,000 hours of fleet time, which is about only 25% to 30% on the way to full airplane maturity, tells me that this airplane is just getting better and better and better day in and day out.
Which becomes extremely significant, as our colleague from Florida mentioned. When we send the warriors out into battle, I don't want it to be a fair fight. That should not be our policy decision. And the value of a life is a significant component that can't be placed in simple dollars and cents terms. And that's why it is simply important that this generation of fighter becomes so much more significant than the fourth generation, because we're talking about real people here. When you also mentioned the death spiral as far as budgeting, that happens if we decide to cut spending. If we just do a continuing resolution, though, that simply moves the spending to the right and postpones it, is that having the same impact as if we actually authorize some kind of cut to it?
A continuing resolution in FY17 for the program is not as harmful as if it were going to last a very long time. What I mean by that is, right now, I am in the throes of negotiating our Lot 11 airplanes. It's 120 airplanes. That's FY17. In the continuing resolution, I am not allowed, I'm not authorized to spend any more money than I did in FY16 or buy any more of the airplanes than I bought in 16. So right now, my hands are tied when it comes to negotiating Lot 10.
So what we need to do is making sure that could have the same impact as simply doing an outright cut to your program.
Yes, sir,
Let me hit a couple of other things. Look, you've talked also about the cost per unit, and this is a great aircraft, although I have to admit the B still looks like a 57 Chevy. But other than that, it's still a great program here. If you can recall when I was young and we were doing the F-16s, how many we were producing a year? Do you recall the high at the high point of that production what the number was?
I do not recall that, sir. I know it was more than 100.
I bet you weren't doing 43 a year.
No, we were doing a lot more than that.
And the cost per unit still goes up the smaller that is, that number, that lot is.
Correct.
That takes place. Can I ask another question? When do we need to start working on the sixth generation?
Sir, we started that long ago.
Which is another reason why we have to have the fifth in production to use it quickly.
Sir, I would say that part of our termination of the F-35 program will deal partially with the numbers and the rates we're able to buy them, how fast we can get to the end, but also that we have another fighter available for procurement. The Air Force needs to be procuring more than 100 fighters a year with the 1,900 plus that we have now to replace them, because right now the average Air Force fighter is 27 years old, and that's a classic if we are automobiles in several states.
I'll just do this in the 10 seconds I've got left. If there is an overrun on the next lot, who bears that burden, and is that different than in the first lot that came with there was an overrun?
Absolutely. If there is an overrun in the target cost of the lot of airplanes, that is borne 100% by industry, because the contracts we now negotiate with them on the top end of this are their responsibility and their risk.
And is that different from the first lot?
Yeah, that's different for the first four lots of airplanes. We started that in lot five when I first came on the program to balance that risk, sir.
Thank you. Yield back.
Representative Whitman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us today. And again, thank you for your service to our nation. Lieutenant General Davis, I want to begin with you. You've spoken very eloquently about the F-35B and its capabilities. You did recently talk about the ramp rate for the F-35B, saying that it's anemic. Give me your perspective on where you think the ramp rate needs to be on F-35B procurement. And before you begin that, I just want to echo that you have an exceptional Marine there in Major Glines. Go ahead.
I know that, sir. Thanks very much for the question. I'll tell you, the ramp rate right now has been anemic, and it's manifesting itself that we're keeping our legacy platforms going longer. And frankly, we've got some inventory challenges out there on the flight line that are very difficult to address. With your help, we're basically pushing the numbers back up, and it's going to take, we won't recover our full readiness until sometime in the future for what we need to do our job as a Marine Corps the way we need to do it. So right now, the ramp rate is anemic. We think, in talking with Lockheed Martin, that if we could get a few more a year, we'd actually be able to sundown our entire fourth generation fleet of F-18s and Harriers by 2026. That cuts about $2 billion worth of operating costs for sustaining an old airplanes that are not giving us the readiness we really need. They're tried and true, but it's like trying to get me. I did a marathon last year, sir. My first marathon, I was able to go and walk around after this last marathon. I had to lay still for a couple days. And we're seeing that with some of our older airplanes. But we think, like this year, I think we are 16, 20, 20, 20, 21 for the F-35s. We think we could go to 19, 23, 23, 23, 31, and get a max production rate of 37 aircrafts in 23. That pulls all that left and basically gets us out of the old metal earlier and gives our Marines that the capability they need to go fight our nation's battle, and collapses our readiness challenge in a significant way.
Very good. Our job is to authorize and fund that. Rear Admiral Miller, I want to elaborate even more on where the Navy is. Admiral Moran, the Vice CNO, came in the other day, talked about availability of F-18 aircraft, obviously very, very problematic. I asked Lieutenant General Davis about the ramp rate for F-35 for the Marine Corps. If the F-35 ramp rate for the Marine Corps is anemic, then I would say that the ramp rate for the Navy, the ramp rate has no pulse. The question is, if we have these F-35 aircraft that have these exceptional capabilities that we need up there in the air that perform exceptionally, you've had some recent tests of F-35 on the carrier, success there in those tests. This year, we're on track to purchase two F-35s from the Navy. Give me your perspective on how we have this seeming dichotomy, an exceptional aircraft, the F-35, and what it can do. We have unavailability of current Navy inventory of F-18 aircraft. How do we bridge that gap? How do we make the right decisions to get to where we need to be?
Yes, sir. I think you accurately depicted our current situation. First off, on the tests out at sea, we've had some discussion earlier about red flag, and that for us it was taking F-35C out to sea on USS George Washington. Very successful. We learned an awful lot. But the one thing that really jumps out at you from a carrier aviator perspective, 152 arrested landings, 100% boarding rate. Mm-hmm. And this was the bringing fleet pilots, our FRS instructors out there, pretty unheard of. Yeah. Zero bolters and zero one wires. Wow. So it does give us quite excitement for that. So we're working a balance. We need to address the bulk of our fleet right now. We have four F-18 squadrons in every single one of our nine carrier air wings, and the availability is as the Vice Chief described it. So we have to get after that. A lot of different levers, of which one is depot throughput, the other is really the enabler accounts, your spares accounts, your PRE and PRL accounts that work tech pubs and updates to manuals and that sort of stuff, has been underfunded for many years, and now we're starting to see the results of that. So what do we need to do? We have to properly fund and start recovering that readiness of our existing F-18 fleet today. Some of that, one of those, and then procurement is really another lever to pull. Yeah. So I would contend that we need to, and our budget has asked for, at least through the unfunded priority list, additional F-18s to start applying towards that readiness. As we ramp up, we're in a little different position than the Air Force and the Marine Corps with respect to F-35. Our first squadron doesn't start training until next year, and then we don't deploy until 21. So we need to do that in a fashion such that we have the maintenance throughput, such that all of the systems on the ship, USS Carl Vinson, that's going to support that first deployment, that airship integration is fully in place. So our ramp rate right now, even if you seriously changed it, would I have that throughput, and what would that difference be? So I think for right now, our near-term focus is on that on the F-18 readiness issue that we have, and probably in the out years, that's where all of a sudden we may have some opportunity to adjust that rheostat and change that ramp rate.
All right. Very good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Langevin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank our witnesses for your testimony today, and we thank you all for your great service to our nation. Let me say it's a pleasure to be a part of the subcommittee for the first time during my tenure on the Armed Services Committee, and I certainly look forward to working with you, Mr. Chairman, and our ranking member. Congratulate our ranking member on assuming her position on this role, and of course with the other members of the subcommittee. So General Harris and General Bogdan, I come from the Emerging Threats and Capabilities Subcommittee, where I serve as the ranking member, where cybersecurity is one of our highest priorities. So many have been critical of cybersecurity inadequacies within the F-35 program, and I understand that the technology advancements in fifth-generation fighters will be operating on a netted enterprise that will rely upon advanced systems for data links, target mapping systems, and C2 that could be vulnerable to cyber attacks. So obviously, it's imperative that we understand the cybersecurity requirements for fifth generation and beyond fighter programs in order to avoid further cost impacts, schedule delays, and possible cyber intrusions or vulnerabilities. To this effect, last year, Section 1649 of the NDAA required an evaluation of cyber vulnerabilities in the F-35 aircraft and support systems. Can you explain how the current version of the F-35 software addresses security vulnerabilities found in previous versions? Do known vulnerabilities from previous software versions remain unpatched? And are there mitigation techniques for vulnerabilities that remain, whether inherited from previous iterations or new to the current version? General?
As I said before, Congressman, if you look at the airplane itself, I think you will find that the architecture of the airplane when it was designed early on was foremost in our mind was that we were going to export this airplane and other people were going to use it. Therefore, when we built the airframe itself, we ensured that there were things on the airplane that would protect it. I have no doubt in my mind, given the testing that we've done so far, that those safeguards on the airplane are working well. And the OT community today is doing the penetration testing and the vulnerability testing on the airplane itself. And those reports, when completed, we will make available to the Congress. They would not be publicly able to be seen. We'd have to do that in another place. But as I said, the bigger problem that we see is on our offboard systems that are connected to various networks. And when the system was originally designed, the maintenance system and the mission planning system on this airplane, we didn't know what we didn't know about the threats. And the threat, cyber-wise, continues to evolve day in and day out. So it is sometimes a catch-up game for us to be able to recognize what the current threats can do and figure out a way to get that into our systems.
Do we know if known vulnerabilities from previous software versions remain unpatched?
I will tell you that there are vulnerabilities in the system today that we know about that we are trying to fix. Can we fix them all at once with the flip of a switch? The answer is no. But we put other mitigation strategies in place to ensure that that vulnerability doesn't become a risk or a problem. Additional inspections, where we use the system, how we use the system. But it is a true statement that today there are vulnerabilities that exist that we are trying to fix.
Okay. Harris, do you have anything to add?
Sir, I would also add that with cyber, all vulnerabilities generally go down to the weakest link, which means a lot of times it's our young men and women that are working on the airplane or plugging into it with something. So it comes back partially to a training and making sure they understand the process and procedures they can follow, and that social media and other things have no place in this type of an environment.
So to that particular point, I believe we must consistently ask how warfighters are training and building confidence with the advanced technologies that they're going to be using. And while I'm new to the subcommittee, I believe that general principle holds true across disciplines. So how are we doing as far as pilots getting training hours to become confident in their abilities inside the aircraft before they take to the skies in combat scenarios?
Sir, we're doing well on that. We're working through the simulated environment to make sure that they get that training before the first sortie, and that's actually part of the congressional help that we had at Luke Air Force Base, standing up the simulators and the facilities. The team is doing extremely well, the maintainers in the tech training, so that by the time they go out and complete their training, whether it's as an operator or a maintainer, the results speak for themselves at Red Flag. 92% MC rates are better than we're seeing across any other fighter fleet.
Thank you, General. Mr. Chairman, I hope that the report that General Bogdan referred to, once it's available, be forward to the committee so we understand the cyber vulnerabilities that have been addressed or still remain. And I have some other questions I'd like to submit for the record, if possible. With that, I yield back.
Great. Thank you, Representative Langevin. You've been a great advocate on the issue of cyber, so we appreciate your comments. With unanimous consent, I recognize Doug Langevin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for letting me join this important hearing. I am a strong supporter of the F-35 program. Fifth-generation capabilities are essential to our nation's defense. I do remain concerned about the pilot escape system, especially the ejection seat. So I have a few questions on that, and I'm not sure who to direct this to specifically. Okay. Thank you, General. As you know, the Air Force discovered that pilots who weigh less than 136 pounds were at high risk of severe injury or death during ejection. The program review last year by the Director of Operational Test and Evaluation from OSD stated, quote, "The extent to which the risk has been reduced for lighter weight pilots by the modifications to the escape system and helmet is still to be determined by a safety analysis of the test data," unquote. So that's what I'm going to pursue. So first of all, how many tests to date have you done to qualify the Martin Baker ejection seat for the F-35?
Multiple different kinds of tests, but if you're talking about the actual, no kidding, shooting the ejection seat with a dummy in it to check, I believe we've done on the order of about 19 to 23 tests. And we are completed now with all of those tests. The last few tests that we did over the last 5 or 6 months included the 3 fixes that were necessary to reduce the risk of those lightweight pilots in an ejection scenario. The first of those fixes was a lighter helmet. Mm-hmm. We've built those lighter helmets and have them now. The second was a sequencer switch on the seat that could be selected by the pilot if he's a lightweight pilot or a heavyweight pilot, and that reduces the opening shock on ejection. And the third is a head support panel that is placed on the risers so that when the parachute does come out during ejection, the pilot's head cannot be snapped back. All three of those fixes were designed. All three of those fixes are now tested. All three of those fixes are now getting ready to be cut into production. The one last test I have to do for the entire ejection seat system is put all of those together and fire electrons at it to make sure triple E testing is done. That testing is scheduled in March, sir. As soon as those tests are complete, we will have all the reports necessary to hand to the services so that they can make the determination that the risk has been reduced enough to lower the weight of the pilots. We're not waiting for that. We're now putting the kits together to retrofit all the airplanes out there with the lighter helmets, with the helmet support, and with the switch, so that if the services give us the okay in April, we will start modifying airplanes. The data that I have seen so far, and it's not the final data, indicates that we've reduced the risk not only for lighter pilots, but all pilots in an F-35 from a problem with neck loads with these three fixes, and that is an improvement for across all of the pilot population, and we will be able to remove that restriction down to 103 pounds. But it just took some time to get it done, and now we're getting it done.
And I know that there's another model out there or available, and I want to really be making sure that we compare the risk of what is currently in place versus the alternative model that is available to make sure we're not having unacceptable risk to our highly trained and valuable pilots.
And we agree with that. When we did originally pick the Martin Baker seat over an ACES seat, that risk was done. In 2010, the U.S. Air Force did a second look to make sure that the Martin Baker seat was the right seat, and they did it. But notwithstanding all of that, with the three fixes we've had to make, the Air Force has sent me direction that they want me to relook once again to make sure that the Martin Baker seat is fully capable of protecting our pilots as best we can and compare that to what a future ACES seat would look like. We're in the process of doing that right now.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear that.
We're doing that right now.
And a couple background questions real quick before my time's up. What is the total cost to the program that's been incurred because of all this 19 to 23 tests and the future test you're talking about?
Zero. When the problems with this occurred, we went back to industry and said, we believe that we've given you enough time and enough money to design this seat appropriately. Therefore, any changes that have to be made in the engineering, the retrofitting, and the production cut-in ought to be borne by industry and not the government, and they agreed. So right now, the U.S. government is not paying for any of those fixes, sir.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Gentlemen, we've come to the end of the hearing. I want to give you an opportunity, if any of you have additional comments, if there have been questions that I've been asked or information that you think would be important for this committee, I want to give you an opportunity to take this opportunity. Any additional comments?
Sir, I just want to thank the committee for your continued oversight. I've been on the program for almost 5 years. I have a tremendous working relationship with your staffs, and I appreciate that. We try and be as open and as transparent as we can. We understand you have a tough job to do. I will tell you, this is not the same program it was many years ago, and we appreciate the support that this committee has given to the F-35 program. Thank you, sir.
Great. Thank you. Then with that, we'll be adjourned.